Good afternoon. Welcome to our School Board Leadership Council workshop. I'm really excited about this part of the budget process and thankful for all that are, who are here, all the Leadership Council. We also have Town Councilor Chiazzo here and our full school board along with a community member in the audience. Today, during this part of the budget workshop, last night you heard a bit about the what is in the budget. This session is designed to be how do our leaders plan to use the monies and the resources that are outlined in the budget. And then tonight, you'll hear more about why this budget matters and why this budget is essential for us to deliver effective programs for our students. So, in the name of baseball season getting started, I thought we would use a little baseball theme. So here is the all-star lineup today. You're going to hear less from me during this workshop, and I'll be speaking more tonight to you, or I will be speaking to you tonight directly. So we'll do welcome and introductions if we feel that we need to do introductions. Then we'll go over the rules of the game, and then you'll hear first from Kate Bolton, our business manager, and we'll work through the lineup in this way, with each principal or director speaking specifically to their portion of our budget so that you have a chance to learn and then ask questions. And so I will be using a timer to keep us on track so that everybody has ample time to articulate their needs and their requests through this budget. And then there will be like a 5-minute question in between. So I will let you know where those breaks are gonna happen. My notes are over there on the side, but I will be using a timer, and just ask that when you hear the timer go off, if you're mid-thought or sentence, that you wrap it up in that sentence and then allow for the next part of the budget to happen, just so we stay on track. It sounds like we have a lot of time together, but I'm guessing it's gonna go by really quickly. So that was a little bit of the rules of the game, and no hustling, no stealing from anyone besides chocolates, and you can't get out of the room. So we'll try to follow those protocols and those norms that I just talked about in terms of honoring each other's time and using the timer. But if you know, I'll give you 3 warnings, and I'm not sure what'll happen, but there will be a consequence. And now Kate's going to talk to us a little bit about what you have in front of you and more of the rules.
I want that. Hey, Todd, can I get one of those?
Yeah.
That's nice.
We can make that.
You don't know where to put it. That's the problem.
Yeah, you're right. Third stall from the left. Yeah. Right? I'm going to do a little bit of a housekeeping moment here before I turn this over to my colleagues and let them speak to you about their work. The first thing I'm doing is I'm asking folks to take an index card and pass them around. This is going to be our parking lot piece. In some places and times we've done a chart paper or some kind of a note-taking process so that we can make sure that we don't lose track of important ideas, but things that might potentially sidetrack us or take too much time in this particular venue. So what we're going to do is ask folks to jot down on index cards any topic that they would like more information on, but that they don't really feel like we have the time or the resources here to address that topic. And we'll collect those at the end of this portion of the day, and we'll make sure that we have a chance to circle back to folks and give them the feedback or the information that they're looking for. But we thought we'd try that as a method for making sure that we don't lose track of important ideas, but that we also notice that we have a limited amount of time today to get through all of these folks having a chance to speak. Second piece of housekeeping is to make sure that everybody has some version of the budget book. I know that the board last night, I believe everybody received the spiral bound one that includes the municipal budget as well. And we're sort of chapter 8 of that book. But we also have handed around some loose leaf bound ones for folks that are working with us just on the school portion of the budget. And I think, you know, I hope that these will be useful because you can tuck things into pockets and pull things out and scribble on them and write notes. For those of you who have received these books in the Leadership Council last week, I actually have a correction to make. So again, housekeeping. If I can get everybody to turn to page 39 in this book. This won't be in the town one, so if you don't have one of the binder ones, let me know. I have a couple more over here. This is a special services section, and through all the backs and forths that I did trying to pull the book pieces together, I grabbed the wrong intro for Allison's section, and she was nice enough to provide me with the correct numbers. Not a huge difference, but if you look at the first paragraph that says special education, and if the last sentence says currently about 13% of our students receive special education services, the figure for this year is 14%. If you have a 13 instead of a 14, you need one of these because this will replace it. And I'll just hand these around, and anybody who has the wrong number can switch it out. As far as the book is concerned, I think we're going to be referring to it a lot during the next few weeks. I'm hoping it's a good, useful resource for everybody to sort of spend time with and dig in a little bit deeper on what's actually involved in the budget. I'd like to thank everybody here in the leadership team for helping me create the content for this. There's an enormous amount of work that's gone into it, and I think that what we hope it's going to be is a window onto our community, a window into what we're thinking and what we're doing in the schools on a daily basis, and why we're asking for the resources that we are asking for. So navigating the book, there's a table of contents up in the front. The same is true of the bound one that the town has. And essentially it goes by school and department. There's a section for each group, and then there's some summary information at the end. There's a section on the capital budget. There's a section on the other funds, adult learning and school nutrition. And then at the end, there are some supporting documents available. So there's a lot to read here. And what I'm hoping is that by the time we get to the end of this session, we'll have given you some milestones or road signs or directions in how to read this book and what's important in it to us. What's the most important takeaways that we want you to have about the way that we've built the budget this year. Does anybody have any questions or needs as far as the resource piece is concerned?
Okay.
Dead silence.
Okay.
We must be perfect.
So just to kind of kick us off, I always like to start with reminding us of our mission and why we exist. So I'll just read this to bring forward to us and make sure that we're keeping in our discussions the students at the center of our discussions. So our mission reads this: the fundamental purpose of our schools is ensuring high levels of learning for each and every student. Therefore, we will do whatever it takes to bring all students to their full potential. And again, intentionally bold and uppercase when we're talking about all students. And then I also want to just bring your attention to the quote that's always there, but might start to feel like wallpaper because you're used to seeing this so many times. But this quote says, good problem seekers are in higher demand than good problem solvers. And I think this captures really some of the shifts that we're experiencing as educators. And so I wanted to start off talking about a little bit how our work has changed. And you may have seen a video like this. Some people refer to it as Shift Happens. But I'm going to share this with you and give you a chance to just kind of think about how quickly the world has changed but is continuing to change. And while you're watching it, I want you to think about, what does that mean for education? What does that mean for our teachers who've been doing this work for 15, 20, 30 plus years, or our leaders who have been doing this for 15, 20, 30 plus years, and be thinking about how their job has changed and how the work has shifted in order to ensure that we're preparing our students for success.
Thank you.
wake you up at that song, mm-hmm. too. So turn and talk to the person next to you. What kind of shocked you? Did you already know that? There's been various versions of this created. What was one thing from this presentation as you're thinking about education that you noticed? Or that resonated with you? So wrap up your thoughts that you're sharing with your colleague next to you. Is there anyone who wants to share something they said or something someone else said? Donna, then Chris.
Well, I was just mentioning that my 1.5-year-old grandson swipes, uses Kindle, uses an iPad, and he barely talks yet. And I wonder what education is going to be like for him. And we've got to plan for that because in 3 more years he's going to be here.
In our school.
Yes.
So the physical technology is mind-blowing in and of itself. I mean, that message about computers having the capability of humans, I mean, you see it, right? There's already that first robot who can, like, read emotions, right, and react to emotions that's out there. So, yeah, just the physical technology is mind-blowing and baffling in and of itself. Chris?
So I have a freshman in college that we just paid for, and by the time he's a junior, that will be useless. So I guess what that translates to in education is maybe we need to look at the whole 4-year model of college and education, how we prepare kids for the future.
Absolutely. Kelly?
I just thought when we're seeing all that, how fast everything's changed, it's less important to teach information, it's more important to teach kids how to find it, how to learn, how to be people who can find information when they need it, because there's so much, you could never teach everything anymore.
Absolutely, this knowledge economy that we live in, right? And earlier today, Monique, you were describing to our community business partners what this space is. Can you just say a little bit to how that supports what Kelly's saying?
Certainly. A library used to be a place where you would go and find information. You would access information, look up information. And the Learning Commons model now has shifted, so it's no longer about accessing information, it's about creating information. And that's why the collaborative spaces, the multiple modalities, you still come and access a good old-fashioned book. Nothing wrong with that, but you see computer lookup stations, you see maker spaces where you can actually make things. So it's about creating knowledge as well as accessing knowledge.
Jackie?
I graduated from college before some of you were born, 1959. But I had a professor who said 2 things. He said, 1, it isn't what you know, it's that you know where to find it if you need it. And the second was, and he was a doctor of physical education, get to know your janitor.
2 relevant points still today. Some things aren't changing, right? Any other thoughts you wanted to share, Jen?
I might be slightly biased. I'm just going to admit that up front. But I think it's about certainly showing kids how to find the information. But when I take this in context to all the discussions we had 2 years ago for the one-to-ones at the high school, it's about giving them the tools to be able to go and find the information too. It's one thing if they know how to find it, it's another thing if they don't have access to be able to go out and get it.
Yeah, and so it's this idea of how do we create not just problem solvers, but question askers, right? Students who are self-motivated and self-regulated to ask really tough questions and then want to go and find the answers to those questions. And so we believe that in the budget that we're presenting in this proposal, that we are making some major shifts, some really creative and innovative shifts to better support an educational system that's going to be aligned to providing that type of experience for our students. But we're also recognizing that there's only so much we can ask at one time. So we've really tried to think critically about the resources that currently exist in our organization to think about what is the job that person was hired to do and how is that job different today. So as a central office team, we spent a lot of time going department by department, and they had blue post-its and pink post-its. blue post-its to say what are the big buckets of work that are getting all of your time, and what are the pink post-its for what are the buckets of work that are not getting the time that it deserves or the time that it needs. And then how can we work more strategically, more efficiently, and more effectively to accomplish those things with our existing resources. So I think it's really important that the community knows that our thought was first with our existing resources. And so you're going to hear about some of that from our Leadership Council today, and you're going to see some evidence of that really thoughtful strategic work. And then where we do ask for new investments, we were really thinking about what do we need to be future ready? What do we need to be a continuous, learning, growing organization so that we make sure we're not looking back and saying, how are we going to fill this gap? And so, you know, the easy answer in this budget climate, when we're looking at the loss of revenue that we're looking at, would be to just level service fund our schools. And I caution our community to do that. I caution our community to spend too much time and energy even thinking about that. Because if we wait, if we level service our schools and we don't continue to innovate and create and grow with our knowledge economy, I literally am not being dramatic. I feel like we will not be able to fill that gap because that it would require so much work that our community would not be able to withstand that. And so this idea of continually improving, and it doesn't mean continually adding. It means realigning. It means rethinking and reassessing our structures each and every year, which I know this Leadership Council is committed to doing. That's not something new. Since I came on board, they've been doing that, but I think that what my newness brings is a lot of wonder and lots of questions that I'm able to ask, and just a different lens to say, okay, well, why do we do that? And just those conversations in and of themselves, I hope our Leadership Council feels, have been helpful in us creating the budget that you're going to learn more about here today. So the challenge for us as school leaders is that, and that's really small there in the middle, but we didn't want to use an acronym, so we gave you the whole mission right there. But we're really talking about the thorough and efficient educations that our students have a constitutional right to. That hasn't changed. We are still required to prepare our students for success for today, tomorrow, and the future. And so that's our mission right there in the center. But what we're feeling is like this force field of pressure from all sides. So we have pressure coming from the state with the reduction in state funding. Yes, the good news is that's our new reality, and we can all, after a couple of years, we'll get acclimated and adjust. But that means that I, as your superintendent, have to think really strategically, along with our leadership, at how are we still going to fund education? Because there's one thing I can guarantee you. It's not going to get more affordable to fund our students. The cost of education is going to continue to grow as our economy grows. And so that has to be something that we all kind of wrap our minds around and embrace and think about, okay, so how do we do this new thing called education? And I say new thing because what we're really doing is reinventing education. The experience that you had in education, the experience that I had in education, isn't going to cut it. We cannot want for our children today the education that we had. And so there's that pressure, but that reality hasn't changed. We also have, you know, rising fixed costs with our wages and our benefits and supplies and energy and services. That's a pressure that's squeezing in on that mission. Local tax increases and the community's ability to pay. This is something that we're so cognizant of. We know that our 55-plus community is growing faster than our school-age community. And we know that some of our seniors aren't going to be able to continue to carry the burden of this social responsibility called education. So again, that goes back to how are we going to creatively fund education? How are we going to build more partnerships with some of our industry in the area so that we are building a pipeline of students who have the skills and attributes that they're looking for in employees? The other pressure that's coming at us and squeezing in on that mission are unfunded mandates. We're making a huge shift to a proficiency-based education system. That costs time, that costs resources in terms of professional development and having the right strategic leadership in place so that our teachers are getting the support they need to build this plane in flight. That's literally what we're doing, right? And also, we're still learning about what the new, what every child, every student succeed act is going to look like and how that's going to impact our funding both at the federal level and at the local level. And then, of course, special education. More and more of our students are coming with more complex needs, And in a public school, we are required to provide them what they need. That's not an option and it's not a choice. So we have to be really aware of how to best service our students in the least restrictive appropriate setting. And then 504, looking at that, you know, that civil rights bill that allows us to, or requires us to ensure that all students have access. And so there's more pressures than that, but I didn't want to overwhelm you. It's our job to handle all those pressures, but I thought it was really important to just kind of put the current reality right in front of us all so that you understand the work that's happening in our schools. And now, batter up, Monique. Would you like to come up here, or are you more comfortable there?
I'd like to stay here if possible.
Sure.
How far is that clicker? What I'd like to do is identify three areas that were of focus across the district from last year and talk a little bit about our accomplishments. As you know, we've sought to increase the professional learning time, and there was a significant increase at the high school. We have a lot to do in order to retool and make those transitions towards the type of education that Julie described. We really are preparing students for the future, but we're living and operating also in the present. So supporting staff and making those changes and those system changes is most important. So for example, we've got developed a common language for teaching. That's part of the process. But we're also growing staff in order to work collaboratively with each other to design lessons, plan, implement them, reflect on them, and create improvements in their lesson planning, all the way to exploring our scoring, grading, reporting practices and their effectiveness, as well as looking at the guiding principles in moving forward, and certainly the high school self-study in terms of NEAS. They've got great gains and they're on target for the visits. Other area of focus was to expand the capacity. As you know, increasingly the digital curriculum materials are becoming more and more web-based and online. Managing that has become a bit of a challenge. The days are gone where you get a committee together and you decide on a textbook and it gets delivered and you stamp it and then you hand it out and maybe do a little professional development around that. Now it's about identifying software applications to help us do our job better and more efficiently. It's about figuring out whether they are compatible with our systems or not. It's about figuring out how where the information is stored, whether that's secure or not secure, how it can be accessed. And then we roll that out to folks, and then we have to train folks to use that software. And so it's a much more complex picture and requires additional staffing. We benefited from the increase of a 0.5 position last year, and we were able to add some of these pieces of software in terms of productivity. One in particular we've been waiting on for about, what was that, Joanne, 4 years, which is our health software piece. But in terms of instruction, we've added some K-12 software subscriptions that have really helped move us along in terms of formative assessment data, Pear Deck and Globster, which allows an online poster for students to build online posters and timelines. The third piece, rather large piece, was to continue with our K-5 curriculum implementation. As you know, I've reported to the board over time on this, and our focus has been in developing classroom libraries, as well as supporting teachers and learning the new instructional methodologies. So an indicator, for example, we are starting to have to look at our benchmarks we have for students. So here's a little example. We used to expect our kindergarten students by the end of the year to know about 21 high-frequency words. And by the time we get to the end of the year, there'd be some who would, some who wouldn't. Well, imagine the day, which is right now, where in January, the average of every single classroom, kindergarten classroom, was over 21 high-frequency words in January. In January. So it's really causing us, the implementation of this for curriculum is really causing us to take a look at our benchmarks. Our kiddos are growing as a result of these this curriculum implementation. So the short message here is, where we invest, we see gains. Moving forward, as Julie described, we would love to expand the professional learning time that we have. like to include all of those pieces that we've described so we can continue to move our staff forward and our district forward in order to provide that education we envision for all. But we also have some curriculum development work that we're going to continue to need to do, particularly in the digital learning applications areas. We've talked a lot about our STEM opportunities and building those across K-12. We've also talked a little bit about Project Lead the Way and bringing in some of those pieces, as well as continuing on with our literacy implementation. Certainly instructional leadership at the building level in order to support the professional learning and to continue with the work, the improvement efforts we have going. And then lastly, data warehousing, analytics, and reporting is an area we haven't been able to tap. We're just trying to keep up with the digital curriculum demands and productivity demands. So in terms of budget implications for next year, our student-centered budget involved, I was requesting a 1.0 FTE instructional application specialist to help support that work. Certainly you'll see in the budgets at the building levels some additional leadership for teaching and learning. And we're also looking at a digital warehousing and reporting solution. We put some of those pieces on hold. For the mission critical budget, what I've done is reallocated. I've set aside about $40,000, $40,000 from the budget to keep aside so that as we continue to do the exploration work in terms of our staffing for technology, we may be able to add a portion of that funding towards adding an additional part-time position at some point. And then certainly the leadership for teaching and learning will you'll see at the building levels as well. Questions on any of that? I feel like I just gave you, tried to pour a glass of water from a fire hose.
So I just have one. So sure. I'm trying to follow along here in my book, and I've got bits and pieces.
Mm-hmm.
So can you point out where I would find the part where it's going to tell me where your mission critical pieces?
Page 56.
I didn't go far enough.
Page 56.
All right, got it. I expected 55. So,
I really wanted a 1.0 FTE to support the work. What we've done is for mission critical, we reorganized existing personnel, and I sort of kept aside from the budget a certain amount of money in case we actually will really need a 0.5 position to add at some point in time. So I found that within existing resources.
Now I see it. I just hadn't gone as far as I was like.
Thank you.
I'm going to pass around to you also a sheet that summarizes on the green the resources that have been realigned from where, and then the new investments and the realignments, how they support each other. So you kind of have it in one sheet. One spot.
So are those that I can send down?
So are these slides available? Sometimes we have a slideshow, and then we've got the lines where we can make our notes and what have you. Are those anywhere floating around?
Printed. No, we did not put that.
So it's just so you know, it's a little difficult to figure out where we're supposed to be looking if I'm trying to match up my information.
I can make
just if somebody just tells us what page we should be to
as we go through.
Yeah.
Okay.
Helpful for me anyway. Thank you.
Kate's the coach in this game, so she will help us with that.
All
if
right.
you if you want a page reference, just kind of do this, and yep. Kate will
all right
be able to help with that. Any other? Monique, are you still presenting, or are we just
I just handed the clicker over to Jen.
Okay, I have one questions slide, so. For Monique before we move on to the next section.
So I just want to be clear again. So this is at $30,000 in funding for additional staff hours to assist with instructional applications. Offset that with for reduction in level services, instructional supplies, and professional development stipends. So when you do all of that, the mission critical investment for your department would be a $14,400 budget decrease.
Yes, because the data warehousing piece, that money, I allocate about $40,000, which is a typical cost, and pulled that out and deferred that for next year.
Okay.
And then the $30,000 I left in the budget, I hadn't allocated towards anything but this potential part-time position or hours, and that creates that negative amount in the total budget.
Great.
With the teaching and learning positions, those be at the particular school, so those aren't part of your?
Correct. Those are, would come out of those cost centers.
And the improvement strategist position is the title that we're using for that, just so that we're all on the same page. So when you're looking at your sheet and you're seeing the language improvement strategist, that's what Monique is talking about. And that has gone through several iterations because we're trying to really capture what it is that this, we really need this position to do and what it's for, because it is, it's a new creative position in a sense. But we were able to this year have Catherine Ruby at the high school, who was brought on as a consultant and saw the benefit of having that additional support as we're shifting, making some of these major shifts. And so we're trying to replicate that through realignment.
One of the things I personally think that the public looks at and gasps, for example, it says here, data science instructional coach, $75,000. Mm-hmm. Well, people assume that that's the salary that we're going to be paying somebody, which is furthest from the truth. I think to make it more understandable that you put down the range that it could be. In other words, what's the entry level and what do we normally hire at? People with 4 or 5 years experience, sometimes more, but what's the average? What's the average on health insurance if it's a single payer or a family? How much does the town contribute? And then what are the other benefits? Because when you look at a new position and it says it's going to cost us $75,000, people say, I can't make that in the next 5 years. You know what I'm saying? It's inflammatory, I think.
Do you want to speak to that?
I think what we may need, Jackie, is some kind of an asterisk on the page that tells you why we say $75,000. That's mm-hmm. the total cost of an average teacher or professional person with family benefits.
With benefits.
Right. So but do you think it would help if we had some kind of a...
I think you need to separate what the cost of the salary is from what is the cost of health insurance, which is huge, by the way.
Right.
And we're only paying 80% of that. But when people, I tell you, I've been negotiating, and the people know I've been negotiating, and I have people stop me in the market when they hear something like this, and then I explain to them that that's not just a salary, that includes their experience and it includes their health insurance and all of those things. So if we're looking for support for a budget and we're looking at publicizing salaries for new positions or the cost of a new position, I think it should be broken down into what the average salary would be and what the average cost of the health benefits would be, and that makes it a little more realistic.
Yeah, I think it does provide clarity also, so that's, we can definitely work on that.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I agree that it should show what that encompasses, but I disagree that it should be broken out. I worry that once you start creating all these other lines, like science is instructional coach, 75, or you can say whatever, 60,000, and then you have benefits, whatever it is, and all these different things, it creates this image of all these line items. I think, to your point of just adding somewhere on here that a footer that just says, positions include, or in a science instructional coach, $75,000 includes, and then just highlight what figure includes. I think breaking it out just...
Well, but it's true. I mean, if you're looking at it as a layperson and saying, oh, that's their salary, no, it's their salary, plus their Anthem, plus their Delta, plus their main purse, plus their
absolute
work comp, and, all of the pieces that go into a personnel cost. But we don't say that anywhere to Jack.
So I think it's a great point. I think, yes, it needs to be said.
I just don't know that each specific amount per position needs to be
said. Well, we certainly have different ways of presenting the same data, too. So we could have it in broken out and so on. But yeah, I think that's a missing piece. We'll work on that.
Chris?
Just a suggestion, would it be easier just to put something in here that says total cost for the position, and for breakdowns refer to the other, another section that might have a breakdown of each position, so that way you look at that and say, this is the total cost to fulfill that requirement. And then a little asterisk could say total cost includes X, Y, and Z, typically, or something like that. Yeah.
If people, the general public, do not normally rail about the benefits piece. It's the salary piece that they look at and talk about the salary increases. So if a teacher this year is making $45,000 and the benefits are $15,000, so we've got a $60,000 employee, give or take. Mm-hmm. And that person, along with everybody else, looks like they're getting a 6% increase for the next fiscal year. Everybody interprets that as a 6% salary increase, when in fact, part of that is benefit increases, and especially the Maine state retirement now. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's huge.
Yeah.
And we've only had to face that in the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. So I think we're shooting ourselves in the foot if we don't clarify.
We'll definitely work on that. Thank you for that feedback. Any other questions about curriculum and instruction? Okay, Jenlyn?
Okay, I am going to wander around.
You wander around. I'm going to direct people. Instructional technology section starts on page 59 of the booklet. And I'll warn you that a big chunk of what goes on in Jen's world is actually reflected in the town's budget book, which I don't have here, just because of the shared services model. What we have here is really reflective of specifically what's going on in the school section. And it'll be the next four pages beyond page 59.
So just a quick explanation about that. There are definitely pieces that are shared by the school and the town. So for example, MUTIS, the MUTIS core system, that piece is shared by both the town and the school. So what you see in the school budget is what we have deemed to be the school portion of what the usage is of that core system. So that's why some of it's kind of split out. And then there are some things that are just town and some things that are just school. One of the things I want to point out before I get into this is that if you look at the bottom line here, we are starting to, well, we have been over the last 3 years, migrating refresh and replacement costs from CIP to operating funds. So in the past, traditionally, any of the refresh budget for any of the phase levels was kind of stuck in CIP. And that would include purchase of devices, infrastructure, carts, projectors, any kind of peripherals. What we started to do at the request of the town council was to take things that technically should be under the operating fund and move them there. So things like a device, which may not last 5 years, the way that I looked at it was your capital purchases would be anything that would kind of outlast 5 years. So I've split it out over the past couple of years so that things like carts, our carts tend to go, you know, 10, 12 years. Projectors, we just finished replacing projectors at the high school that had made it 9 and 10 years. So those types of things, like infrastructure work, so our servers, our routers, our switches, cabling work that has to be done, anything that's, you know, we've been trying to work to upgrade from Cat 3 to Cat 6 cabling, any of that work is put into CIP. Any of the actual devices, dock cameras, remotes, things like that, would go into operating. So the first year, which I think was like two years ago? Yeah. Initially, we started out with about $15,000 in that line item. So we started to move funds in there, and now we're up to 400 and...
We've done $300,000 chunks, basically. So,
yeah. So that's good. You'll see that as a fairly big impact on the operating side, because when you go from 15 to 450,000, it looks like it's a huge increase, but really it's just sort of a reallocation of funds. okay, I'm not gonna do really deep dives into these because we've already discussed a lot of this at the school board meeting. I don't want to bore anybody, but if you have questions, let me know. The biggest issue that we have coming up next year, the biggest budget impact, will be the middle school technical refresh. As you all have heard from me and the press, the state is doing away with the Maine Learning Technology Initiative, MLTI program, as it has existed for the past 15 years. So essentially, instead of handing a device out to students and saying, here you go, this is taken care of for the next 4 years cost-wise, they have opted to, the last time I think we met, I didn't actually have the parameters. What they're going to do is basically give us $200 per seat per year for a term of 3 years. And schools can spend that any way they want. So we're not handed a, we're not forced to choose a MacBook or, you know, an HP laptop. We can get Chromebooks if we want. So I wanted to show this to you because this is what we have chosen. The last time we met, I think you know that we went through a list of requirements. So we did requirement definition sessions with the teachers and the students, and we collected things that they would like to have in device, nice to haves, need to haves. And then we went out and chose, I'm gonna say, 5 or 6 different devices. We handed those out to students and teachers alike. We had them test them over several months, give us feedback, and they chose this Lenovo N23, and then there was an HP model. The HP model ended up being significantly more expensive, so we have opted to go with this. It's a lot like, if any of you have kids in the high school, it's a lot like the Lenovos that are at the high school. It flips into a tablet. It has 4 gig of RAM, and it has 32 gig hard drive. So one of the concerns heading into using Chromebooks was, well, what if kids have to work offline? They can work offline, they can store and save their work, and then they can forward it when they reconnect. So I'll just, you know, just want to get that.
Can I take that home?
So it's actually not even charged up. I just wanted to give you an idea. They are semi-ruggedized.
So $200 per student per year for 3 years is what the state's going to give.
Right.
And it's not going to be on that.
That's what they're currently saying.
Oh, okay.
Right, so yeah. Anticipate that the reality might be a little different.
But it's not going to be a grant-based where...
It is going to be grant-based. So we are going to have to apply for the grant. So one caveat there is they have said that all 7th and 8th grade students in state of Maine and all middle school staff, teachers, will qualify for the $200 per seat for a year, for 3 years. There's a possibility that I might be able to cover the high school teachers too. I'm still trying to figure that out. The sixth grade will not be covered, so we will have to purchase the sixth grade devices, which we assumed up front. Don't forget too that this is a flat out purchase reimbursement program. So these devices here that you're looking at, our base price for the unit is $225. We'll be purchasing some insurance on it, and there's some other things. So, you know, all total probably be just over $300. That's an upfront cost for us, and then we're going to have to get the $200 per year per seat over 3 years back from the state. Julie and I had a number of conversations because although those parameters have sort of been set out into the public on a one pager from the DOE, the question is still sort of outstanding in my mind of what are the grants application parameters going to be. So how are we going to actually qualify for this? Is it going to be needs-based? So taking that into consideration up front, the fact that we had to get our budget in fairly early, we just went ahead and just planned to self-fund, and then we're going to get whatever we can back from the state. But if that ends up being needs-based, it'll just be a portion of what they're offering out to other schools. We are, I think I mentioned before, just to give everybody a heads up, we did get word from the state the last time we talked. The state had said, if you purchase the existing HPs that we have, of which we have roughly 1,000, it said $18 per, and you have to purchase all or nothing. The state came back and said, you can purchase as many or as little as you want. So we have opted, we'll probably be purchasing around 300. A portion of those will be moved over to Wentworth to be used as hot swaps. so that we can take the Wentworth laptops, which were scheduled to go on a 4-year cycle, we're going to try to push them out to a 5-year cycle, just to save a little money. There will be other machines that we will clean up, re-image, and redeploy for some other activities, like probably some STEM, STEAM stuff. They're, you know, keep in mind they're 5-year-old devices at that point. They have 4 gig of RAM. They have, you know, i3 processors. Not super powerful machines, but they're workhorses. They'll work for, you know, sort of basic things. There's a couple of other things that we're going to be purchasing. There's some projectors that we have to replace at the middle school. There's a couple of needle boards that we have to replace. Fairly minimal. So the bulk of that budget really will be the purchase and launch of the devices. Good news is we don't have to purchase, you know, all the software that came with the MLTI devices traditionally in the past, because since they're Chromebooks, it'll be application-based. Questions about that?
Jen, I think it's important to say that a typical tech refresh amount, even replacing the MLTI devices the way that we need to do at this time, doesn't change our budget for it.
Yes.
It's consistent with the amount that we would have spent to refresh in a given phase in a given year anyway.
We are actually, this year, will be coming in under the last tech refresh at the middle school. By, I'm going to just throw it a ballpark figure, by about $70,000. Because with the Chromebooks, I mean, if we were to go out and purchase one of the HP 4440s or 440s that we have at the middle school right now, those are going to run you about $512. So it's, you know, we can get two of those for every laptop.
Jen, are we when you say we're going to refresh, are we buying the approximate 7? With the student body and the about 800 devices for the middle school.
Yeah, so it'll be about 850 with hotspot devices.
Okay.
About 850 for them, and then we will be purchasing full-fledged laptops, Lenovo laptops, 14-inch for staff. They do have the software requirements that they have to have. So we'll be purchasing roughly 100 of those, which they are testing devices right now. We've narrowed it down to two. My gut says they're going to go with the Lenovo that's very similar to that, but it's a full-fledged laptop instead of a Chromebook.
So $250,000, give or take.
Don't forget that when we, yes, for the devices, but when we purchase the devices, because the state program now through MLTI provides bags, provides chargers, provides, you know, keyboard, like all that kind of stuff, so we're going to be outputting for that. It's going to be roughly $352
okay.
for everything. But we hopefully will get a portion of that back from the state over the next 3 years.
But our outlay is going to be, in subsequent years, if we won't replace all of them, you will want to cycle them, right?
Yes, that's the hope, yeah. Because now we have Chromebooks at the K2s, and we'll have Chromebooks at the middle school. So the hope is if we can start to sort of make that consistent throughout the district over the next, you know, 3 to 5 years, we will start to be able to rotate throughout the entire district.
Thank you. Sounds great.
Do you have any network or infrastructure changes required with this transitioning out of the state's MLTI into ours?
I'm glad you asked that because, we talked about this before, but MLTI did provide a network, and we did actually participate in the state-provided network through a company called ENA. Over 3 years, we had a significant number of issues, from latency to dropped connections. We were constantly having to reboot those access points, which I think actually we buried them in the ceiling here, but they're those sort of spaceship-looking things that everybody can connect to for wireless. We had to keep rebooting those. I don't think we had enough of them. We had the company come in and do what they call a heat map twice to just make sure we had enough coverage. We were continuously having problems. So last summer, we opted to just take it out and put our own network in. It helped with staff at the middle school too, because with them being on a segregated network, it made it more difficult for them to do things like wirelessly connect to projectors that were all on the district network and they weren't, so they couldn't talk to each other. So we did that and we returned all the equipment to the state. We're pleased that we did that in the end because the state now is saying that they are not going to provide that anymore. So there are a significant number of school districts that are struggling trying to figure out what they're going to do at this point. So we're fine. We're now all on the same network. I feel really confident that we're totally adequately covered. We just had online testing down at the middle school, everybody online at once testing, and it was fine. So in terms of bandwidth, I think we're in solid shape.
Just two points of reference to support what Jen is sharing with us. If you're looking at the whole town budget book, either in person or online, her section in the town book starts on page 26. So if you wanted to look at that aspect of it. And then also, recently Jen did a presentation at our school board workshop, and so that will also be posted in the budget portal so folks can access that for reference, because there was a lot of information shared in that presentation as well.
That was a deep dive into the devices that we chose and the requirements for the devices and all that kind of stuff. So if you don't find the information that you want in there, feel free to just call me or email me.
I did attach that to the budget portal this morning. I noticed that the structure of the budget portal is a little wonky as far as like being able to post backup documents. It's more of a news feed. But there's two news feeds, or two new items in there, two new posts. One of them is Jen's presentation with a little intro and an attachment with her PowerPoint. So we got it there.
Any other questions about the MLTI middle school? Okay. DRBCP, so disaster recovery, business continuity planning, something we talked about at the last school board meeting where I updated you guys is that we did finalize our disaster recovery plan for my department, and we found a few things that we could definitely fix, update, upgrade. So we are going to be taking care of that over the next year in conjunction with Todd. We're kind of combining budgets and we'll be putting in some backup power and then redundancy, which will give us network access sort of self. So we'll be putting it somewhere. We haven't decided exactly the location, but we will be putting basically a backup location somewhere down in the Pine Point area. That's going to require some hardware. It will require us to be pulling some fiber, likely, and then we'll have to purchase some backup hardware, install it, and then we'll have to get the backup power and connect everything. So that's probably going to be done, I think, over the summer, maybe. Fingers crossed. All right, questions about that? Okay, restructuring. I'll go to STEM-STEAM first. We'll come back to restructuring. So STEM-STEAM, we've kind of already talked about that, but we will be supporting NAF and Project Lead the Way and anything else that they need in terms of getting the appropriate software, making sure that it works on the devices we have, and if it doesn't, which we know in some cases it definitely won't, we'll have to be going out and taking a look at some devices that we might need to purchase. And then along with anything else we can, my staff is always great, they're flexible, can't say enough good things about them. They're always ready to kind of dig in and help out, so they frequently do help out with training and whatever else is needed. Restructuring, so thanks to Julie, we really have started to dig in and take a look at the structure of our department and kind of how it works. My department is a little more difficult because some people are town employees, some people are school employees, and it's some people are deployed in the field all the time, and some people are stationed in, you know, sort of at our home base in town hall. So we're taking a look at kind of vertically aligning our workflows and then also our reporting structures and kind of our pipeline to make sure that everybody's cross-trained appropriately and that we're really using our resources efficiently. Because at this point, we are getting to a point where we are one-to-one district-wide. As of next year, we're going to own every single device. So in the past, with MLTI, if there's an issue with the machine, we box it up, send it back to the state, and get a hot swap. This way, we're going to, with owning these devices, we're going to be responsible for the fixes. So now we've got 3,000 devices. At the last school board meeting, we discussed where in 5 years, the number of devices that we support has doubled. It's gone from roughly 3,000 to roughly 6,000. So we are at a point where we're probably going to need additional staff. Before we do that, at Julie's suggestion, we're going to take a look at the staff that we have and kind of see how can we better align the workload and create some more efficiencies and hopefully just maybe ask for one person. So we'll be doing that over the next year.
Jen, how many desktops do we support in the school department? Support staff primarily have desktops, is that correct?
No, not necessarily. The number of desktops has gone down. So desktops, 293.
In the school department?
We used to have 557. Yeah. Well, because at back office admin staff, we'll all have desktops. Yeah. And then there are some desktops that still support special services. And we have scattered desktops here and there, but not a lot. I mean, that number, that's almost a 50% decrease over the past couple of years. Primarily, we tried to create much more mobility. That was my goal coming into the district, was everybody should be mobile. Nobody should be tethered to a desk. We should be able to go from the learning commons to the cafeteria to, wherever, and be able to do your work.
Thank you.
Do you want to hand off the clicker? Yes, to Allison. And just for a little time check, we are ahead of schedule. So for those of you who are looking forward to that, and I do have a 5-minute break scheduled for after Allison's presentation, if anyone's feeling like they need a break.
So Allison's section starts on page 39, has an amazing amount of useful information about what special services really is. When we first started pulling that together last year, I thought I knew everything, was really quite surprised at all of the things that these folks are in charge of and have the pleasure of dealing with every day. So, a lot of good info in that section.
Thanks, Kay, for the introduction. This is on page 44 in the notebook. This is at the slide, and these are our mission critical investments for this coming year. We are occupational therapists. We currently have 3.4 OTs in the district, and then we have one assistant OT. By state regulations, an OT cannot exceed a caseload of 50. So that includes any 504 or special education students, and that also supervises any of the work the assistant OT is doing. So we have a maximum caseload capability of 170. A month ago, we're at 169. We have maximized our OT services. We only have two students graduating or aging out that are receiving OT services, and we have more incoming identified KBs coming in. The other thing is one student can count as one, but one student can also count as five in need. So when I said literally we've maximized out our capability, our OT staff are working very hard and doing a great job. So that is looking to increase 0.4 to a 1.0 position for next year. The second request is for another behavioral specialist. 2 years ago, we added our second behavioral specialist, and they were to primarily focus on grades 3 through 12, doing individual assessment, program development, training, and resources for individual students, as well as we wanted a lot of focus to go in professional development for all staff to be able to address student needs within the classroom setting, to look at many students with ADHD or other types of executive functioning needs, and give more supports to classroom teachers meeting the needs of the students in their What we have found with that grade 3 through 12 position this year is at least 90% of the time for that position has been required here at the Wentworth School. We have three significant programs that are being run that require the behavioral specialist to work individually daily. She is also servicing 12 other IEP students, has developed 10 other plans, has done some trainings, did a whole building training here for resources for all staff. It has left us lacking at providing timely services in professional development, but more importantly, meeting individual needs of students in a timely way. We do have the person does go over to the middle school weekly because there is a program there that needs to be run and monitored. But we aren't addressing timely our school avoidance, our school refusal students. We aren't giving the professional development to keep kids in the least restrictive setting and be successful. Kids who aren't coming to school or who are disrupting the learning environment of others or who are not accessing their own education. That is what this position is supposed to be digging in and helping. So that is the reason for that request. As always, Julie mentioned the regulations. We're always a phone call away from an unexpected cost. An example is we have a student moving in next month who is in a very specialized day treatment setting for autism, and the student requires two-on-one staffing. They will become ours as they sign the lease and are moving in. That's a significant, that's probably close to $100,000 of budget impact. That's just an example. We also have a huge unknown with our CDS's child development services. So those are our incoming kindergarten students who are already receiving special education services. And we have right now the number changes as people move in or get identified. So we have about 26 students that we're aware of. 11 of those students have a birthday that falls between July 1 and October 15. So the team, including the parent, can choose to still stay in CDS services for another year and hold off on coming to kindergarten. And so 11 of our 25, and 5 of those 11 potential students have high needs that require significant staffing. We are starting those meetings, those IEP meetings next week, and they run for about a month. They're 4 to 6 days scheduled of meeting. Our staff have gone and observed all the students in their settings, but again, that's an unknown. We don't know exactly who will be coming. And then we've had the unexpected needs of our current population. We've had to add an additional 3 staff this year in long-term sub positions as we try to keep the environment not disruptive to the learning of others. The good news is we're always looking at how we can realign our positions. And last year we did not have a budget request for special services. We realigned 2 ed tech slots of kids who were aging out. We had that same situation this year. We have 2 students aging out that have one-on-one ed tech support. And so we will be realigning our K-12 needs and reassigning those. So we've not put in any additional adult support. So we hope that we'll be able to make the shift to accommodate that once we know about our incoming K kids. Then the second slide is just talking about our continued focus on previous investments, and a lot of that is around professional development. A lot of the investments are in time, are in training. So we've
you've heard a lot about executive functioning, study skills. Now you'll also start seeing, hearing habits of work or howls. Those are all behaviors. They're behaviors that support a student in being able to access their learning, and being able to manage themselves and their time so they can access their learning. We have been focused in special education around this issue. I think I've shared before, we've implemented...
Good afternoon, Wentworth. We will begin dismissals in just a few minutes.
So we've already been up and running at the high school with study skills workshop. We have over 60 students enrolled in that, but it's also embedded in instruction in the resource room, academic life skills, and social life skills program. The middle school is piloted a model last year, and they are up and running with 75 students getting targeted instruction around executive functioning, and now we have also included that the staff and the training in our life skills programs at the middle school. And Wentworth is, we've done three staff development meetings, so the middle school staff shared with the Wentworth staff the learnings and challenges of the pilot program for implementation here at Wentworth. So that is very exciting work. Our behavioral strategist has also done a lot of training around that. So we're very excited and we'll continue. That's a primary focus for all kids, and for some students in 504 special education with their disabilities, they require a higher level of targeted instruction. The positive behavior support plans, what I will just say in terms of this is it has kept students here. It has kept students in their home schools by our ability to develop highly individualized plans and provide the training for the staff to consistently implement the plans. It's been a very good investment for Scarborough, as well as for their kids to keep them here. We continue, of course, with the internships and supported work experiences. The Gates program at the high school offers an internship experience. Of course, we've always been talking about expanding that for all students. We currently have 10 students looking at a nursing internship, a job shadowing experience at Maine Med, and we have another 20 students who our Gates teacher is taking over to the Maine Med Research Center to look at opportunities there. We've had somebody work at the Portland Press Herald, a record recording studio, so those opportunities. And then our supportive work experiences are for our high school self-contained special education programs. And we have this year about...
Pickups are now dismissed to the cafeteria. Pickups are now dismissed to the cafeteria.
About 12 area businesses that really work very well with the staff. Kids go with job coaches and they go out weekly. We have an employment for education program in one of our high school classrooms and they go out weekly. So very, very excited about the collaborative work we do with the community on that. Data is, for all of us, Monique talked about, we're just wondering how do we manage all of our data. But data is critical in the identification of our GATE students. You'll notice that we are at a 9% identification rate now in Scarborough for GATEs. We're about 6% for the academic areas and 3% in the visual and performing arts. And a lot of that growth in the visual and performing arts identification has been about using the data.
Group 1 is now dismissed to the bus circle. Group 1 to the bus circle.
Okay. There are only two groups, and that's the clubs.
we purchased some web-based data management tools for acuity, for tracking our 504s, the efficiency, the monitoring, and the management of 504 is at a level now that I'm very certain that we are identifying in a consistent and responsible manner. The other piece of data I just want to quickly talk about is the students' data. We have a focus of helping students become as independent as possible, helping students
sorry, did not know that it was raining outside. Group one is going to the gym. So group one, please report to the gym.
So have the students understand their strengths, their needs, what their goals are. So there are lots of different activities that have happened this year with students developing individual portfolios, students attending IEP meetings and mentioning their strengths and needs. It's been very fun and exciting. We had a district meeting and we had all groups share and report out. Student-driven data is just as important. We had a state requirement that in special education, reading, writing, and math goals, it had to be linked directly into the IEP with a citation of the actual content standard. And we are in a state program monitoring audit process this year. And we use that as an opportunity to do self-assessment, do professional development. So a lot of the work has been targeted on that. When we did our self-assessment, we were at about 74%. In October, we are now at 100% in meeting that compliance regulation. Out-of-district placements is a significant investment the town makes. And we monitor that their progress and are constantly assessing their return plan to Scarborough. We transitioned 5 students back last year, all successfully. And we have another student that we are beginning that transition process on this year. We currently have 5 students placed out in day treatment programs and a state agency client because Scarborough does have a group home and for high school and young adults. And so we have 1 student placed out through our group home. So I know my time, I don't have my timer, but
3 minutes and 21 seconds.
So I'll just touch on a couple of the other areas that we've spent a lot of investments with in professional development. Our inclusive practices, we have contracted this year with an inclusion specialist as well as an autism specialist to go in and observe some students in the regular ed setting, to work with staff, regular ed and special education staff, about how to unpack the curriculum, how to pull out the critical learning pieces for students, how to develop the resources they need before the lesson happens. So that forward planning, the accessing of the technology to get a lower level text or summarize the PowerPoint or use different vocabulary. So that's been a significant focused area for us at Wentworth in the middle school, and we are looking to provide some specialized ed tech training this summer about how to support a student in a class without over-supporting. How to learn how to fade, how to learn how to promote independence. And that's sometimes you aren't even aware. You think you're helping. You're not aware that it's potentially getting in the way a little bit. I think I've generally touched on most everything else. The post-secondary transition plan is embedded in the IEP. We our self-audit had us was a significant area of need. We had someone from the DOE come in and do 2-hour specialized training, and our audit results were 100% after that. So we're very excited about how we've used this audit process in special education to really be a professional growth model. I'm really happy that our GATES number, we're really maximizing in our academics. I think some of that is a result of our curriculums, our math and focus curriculum, and some of those other areas that are teaching critical thinking skills. So lots of great things going on. And certainly answer any questions.
Allison, thank you for that very thorough presentation. And I just want to, in support of what Allison said before we go to questions, bring your attention to the blue sheet that's in front of you that outlines the mission critical investments And what I want you to notice is that although there are some 1.6 FTEs requested as new investments, Allison and Chris have worked hard to find some existing resources that could be reallocated.
AfterCare is now dismissed to the cafeteria. AfterCare to the cafeteria. Group 2, you are dismissed to the gym. Group 2 to the gym.
So it's a lot of coordination to move around. How many students, Cal?
700, just about. Love choreography.
So I just wanted to bring your attention to that. So as each of our leaders is speaking about their investments or their mission critical investments, just to be noticing how we're coming to those numbers. Thank you, Allison.
Thank you. I'll just add one other thing. On page 45, when you look at the pie chart for special services, I think Julie had made a comment last night about 76% of
the district.
The district is in personnel. Notice that the majority of the local budget for special services is all personnel.
Walkers are now dismissed to the main office. Walkers to the main office. Homework club, you are dismissed to B-128. Gym dandies are dismissed to A-131. Civil rights team are dismissed to B-101. And the reading team are dismissed to the reading rooms. All students have been dismissed. Have a great afternoon.
So I just wanted people to be aware that this special education services, materials, equipment, consultants, all of that is funded federally through a local entitlement grant, which was over $670,000 last year. So it takes a lot to meet the needs of the special education, which is, I just don't want you to think we don't need any supplies when you see the whole budget pie there is blue.
Thank you. Questions?
Jody? I just have two things. The first one, where have we been historically with gates? You said we're now currently at 9%. Where has that been in the past?
So for the visual performing arts, it wasn't a requirement to come online until about 5 years ago, so that was a 0%. And so it's grown since then. And we don't begin identifying until fourth grade, given what our curriculums are. So that's seen a steady growth since we began implementing that. And the guidelines are generally up to 5% in the academic and in the visual performing arts. So we're high for the academic area. We have generally been at around 4% in the academic education.
And then my other question is just sort of an ask. Is there a way for you to send us that information? I say us, I really mean Carrie, she's the communications committee leader. The information on the internships and those partners that you work with.
I can certainly send you the list of that.
Yeah, that would be great. I just don't think people in the general public know that that's happening.
Perfect.
Any other questions for Allison? Donna?
So given that, special ed is federally funded, it's partially federally funded, and given that we have to accept every child that walks through the door into our schools, regardless of their needs, what's the percentage of the shortfall in the budget that goes to the district for the citizens to pick up?
Well, are you asking about the state?
So we receive the state and federal funds due to us in special ed funding. What's the difference that we need to pick up
in the general fund?
Some local tax dollars, yeah.
I'm not sure because I think it's what we're asking for, so I know I'm not understanding your question.
You mean the budget in general?
How much do we receive in state and federal funding for special ed versus how much is the total special ed budget? I think it's
pulling
question.
Out special ed out of the special services, so you just see the special education component.
Yes.
And then Kate knows what we receive from the state, but it's only a third of what the real costs are.
A third.
Yeah, I think that to answer a piece of the question, Donna, the state statute right now, we talked a little bit last night about being at minimum receiver status, and the statute actually says that one of the ways to calculate what the minimum amount a district can receive is to look at their special ed costs and to pay a percentage of that. That's actually the figure that the DOE has used this year in their preliminary estimate for what we'll get. So that $2.1 million that we have currently on the list from Department of Ed and GPA is actually, it represents 33% of our special ed costs from 2016. So, I mean, in essence, I mean, what Julie was saying yesterday was, well, I guess if we identified all our kids as special ed, maybe we'd get more GPA. But in essence, it's all of our funding from the state is coming because we have special ed.
I think that's a really, really important point for our citizens to be aware of. In addition to looking at the numbers of kids that have been coming in needing some services for autism, I've been wondering recently about the fallout of children who will be born through opioid addiction or any other drug addictions, and what the impact will be for a child born and then 5 years later in our kindergarten.
Absolutely.
This behavior specialist is, to me, it's like, it's really like, for me, it's like the number one thing for our district. And the reason for that is because we also have to be thinking about protecting all of our teachers when these kids are in our classrooms. We're attempting to support them, but we have to support every teacher who has those kids. They have to have hope that there's some other ideas that they can come up with after it's November 1st, and they've expended everything they can possibly think of to satisfy the needs of this child without burdening the needs of every other child in the classroom. Not sure if I'm making myself clear enough, but I just feel like that position supports not just those special ed kids, but every teacher that comes in contact with those special ed kids is impacted by those.
So just to add to what Donna's saying, you know, Joanne's making a note over here that 1 in 5 babies in the state of Maine
today
are born drug addicted today. 1 in 5 babies. So that's, I mean, 20%. That's pretty significant. And also, what you're talking about too, Donna, is the way that the role of the classroom teacher is shifting, right? And so having to have this whole new skill set of being a highly skilled behavior specialist. I mean, yes, we have, you know, certain behavior specialists that can come in and support kids, but these are strategies and skills that our classroom teachers are learning and applying, not just for special education students, but for some of our general education students as well. So that is a huge...
And they'll learn that through these kinds of people who come in with these specialized ideas of how to do these minute-to-minute plans for individual kids that need to change their behaviors by the minute. It's really so significant. I think it's just right up to me.
So I saw a few hands. I think Jackie had her hand up. Chris?
I just want to know, when did the state stop reimbursing special ed at 100%?
We haven't reimbursed special ed at 100% for a long time. I think I should clarify this a little bit, though, because if you look at page 45, the bottom line request for the special ed department, the services department, is $8.4-ish million. And what we've just said is that the Department of Education is going to send us $2.1 million. Well, that's not 33%. Most of us can sort of figure out that's not quite right. So as I said that, I was thinking, no, that doesn't sound right. The state is figuring out how much money they think we need to run special ed, and they're basing it on prior year spending. So if they were really giving us a third of $8 million, they'd be giving us more.
But not this whole budget is for special education. This
exactly.
is special services.
This budget includes
Gates and everything.
Gates and ESL as well. But to Jackie's point, I mean, for Scarborough, the state is figuring out a total cost for our district, and they're reimbursing special ed at the percentage that they say they're going to reimburse, and then the bottom line changes because of the community's ability to pay. So
So they factor in the special ed costs, they get to an overall cost for the district, but then when they decide how much Scarborough can afford to pay, they only send us the difference. It doesn't come out to...
No, but at one time, all special education costs for all communities were reimbursed at 100%. What I was asking is, how long has that not been going on?
In the calculation of EPS, it hasn't been for some years now. I think that the minimum receiver statute goes back probably 5-6 years or so at the 30-35-ish percent.
All right, and Chris?
You kind of already answered this a little bit, but when does the state look at what our costs are? Because as Allison mentioned, if we have a student that comes in a month or two and it's a $100,000 impact on our budget, do they just look at our average over last year, or is there some way, if we get multiple students moving in, is there some way we could apply for a waiver or additional funding or something like that, or reassessment or something like that?
They really only tackle GPA, which is the state subsidy for education, on an annual basis, and they do it pretty much strictly based on what happened in the prior year. So if you said to the DOE, hey, guess what, we just had to spend another $300,000 this year, they'd say, well, that's great, you will see that impact next year. Have a nice day.
There isn't an annual report, though, that for additional exceeding needs for students, and there's some kind of calculation. We've never met that, but there is an annual report. I forget the number, but that we fill out and submit.
Is that a dollar amount, or is that a percentage of your total budget, or is it volume of the students?
It's a dollar amount on our end, but then they convert it to a percentage calculation.
We're talking about the out-of-district report.
The high needs, right?
Some of those are so we do give them that information, but there's just typically in the GPA calculations, there's typically a lag, and they're typically relying on prior year expenditures. But in special services, that's not necessarily a bad thing, because we have such volatility. Last year's cost could have been higher than this year's cost.
And we try to earmark some of our federal money for those unexpected needs, so there's not the impact on the local budget.
Any other questions about special services? Allison, can you click to the next slide for me, please? So it's about 307.
Want me to keep clicking?
Go back one. I had a snappy little break slide. But anyways, we're going to take a 5-minute break, and so why don't we come back together? It's 3:08.